Praise the Lord. Go ahead and give him a praise as you're seated this morning. We are in the Days of Noah Prophecy Conference, and we have been in the church since yesterday morning, receiving all sorts of teaching and instruction as it pertains to the times that we're living in. How many people know that Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be at the coming of the Son of Man? At another place, we're reminded that it will be like the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. There's a couple things about those days that I don't think we could exhaust in 1 hour, but one thing that really leaps off to me about the days of Noah when I read the pages of my Bible is the fact that Noah was displaying an urgency to people, but people just refused to hear the message that he was trying to convey. The Bible says he preached, and I'm sure he was a preacher. Bible says he was a preacher of righteousness in a world that was full of darkness. He was shining the light, doing what he knew how to do, sounding the alarm, telling people, listen, you better repent, you better turn, you better get your eyes on God, you better come out of this sin. He was shouting the shout. He was blowing the alarm. It was the clarion call that was going forth. But in Noah's day, nobody would listen, as it was in the days of Noah. So shall it be at the coming of the Son of Man. I know there are many other things about the days of Noah that are sobering, but one thing that's shocking is how Noah preached righteousness and declared the truth, but yet only 8 were saved. We have with us today a guest speaker. His name's Brother Russ Dizdar. Yesterday's the first time I ever got to hear Brother Russ speak in person. And I tell you what, I learned a lot of stuff yesterday. How about it, Brother Larry? Russ Dizdar is not afraid to talk about the difficult issues that a lot of people run away from. He's been ordained since 1978. Has ministered as a senior pastor for 4 different churches for more than 30 years. He was also the executive director of Akron Youth for Christ, a police chaplain, founder and director of Shatter the Darkness since 1980, and Preemption Broadcast since 2008. Russ conducts training seminars across the United States as well as crusade evangelism. Russ has a very wide experience in the field of law enforcement. He has attended conferences and seminars, including those on satanic ritual abuse, mind control, spiritual warfare, abduction research, evangelism, and more. He's authored and taught over 14 college-level courses over the last 30 years. Russ is the author of The Black Awakening, which you can find back there on the product table. And he has a heart to see people set free from the power of hell. And that's what I like. He's not afraid to call a devil a devil. And he's not afraid of Satan. It seems to me, and I've only sat under Russ now for a day, personally, I've heard him speak on the internet and things of that nature. But it seems to me that one of the things he wants to make the body of Christ extraordinarily aware of is that we are not to be afraid of Satan or his devices. And we are to defy the kingdoms of darkness on every corner and stand up and not be cowards as Satan does his thing out in the earth. We are to take the gospel and combat in spiritual warfare and come against the lying forces of the wicked one. So I'm excited about what God's going to do in this place today. As Brother Russ and I talked about the service this morning months ago, I paraphrase, but I said something like, you know, we can throw the whole conference out the window for Sunday morning. I said, let's just see people get saved. Let's see people get done. I know we're having this conference. I said, but listen, just let God be God. And I remember Brother Russ said, you know, I'm a preacher at heart. Well, that's a good thing. So we don't have to stick to any conference program, any guidelines, anything we've done. We're going to let God have his way in this place. And I pray that someone came in here today that's bound up by demon spirits, and they're going to leave with a new song and a new step and a new spring in their heart today. I'm believing that. So would you welcome Brother Russ Dizdar to the pulpit today at the Tri-State Ministry Center? Thank you, Brother Russ. Thank you so much.
Stand for a moment, please. Thank you very much. You know, in the churches across the nation, we've been telling people for a long time that, you know, we've seen the average prayer time in a church across the nation being about 18 seconds. You know, there's a scripture verse in the book of Revelation talking about being silent in heaven for about a half hour, right? I don't believe that applies to the body of Christ here on the earth right now, okay? What you understand here is, everybody here is a preacher anyway, right? I mean, listen, to come here, we've already heard about three sermons, and that is great, but we're going to hear some more things today that I think that in some ways will, it's providential, Pastor. It is providential. Let me just begin it this way. You're standing right now, and I feel like I'm going to go for 20 minutes with you standing. So let's do this first. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, God, stretch out your hand in this place. Reach into every single heart in life. God, anyone lost, save. Anyone in any way oppressed, deliver. God, stretch out your hands to heal. And God, in this place, perform miraculous signs and wonders. In the name of your holy servant, Jesus, in this state, in this city, we ask you to bring a radical, a ripping and tearing to the underground, to the darkness, to what's going on all around us. And God, show your hand in this city, in this state, in the areas around. And by the providence of God, those who have come from long distances, God, meet them, speak to them, God, loudly or in that small, still voice that is so clear that it answers everything and liberates. We ask God, stretch out your hands to the right of us, to the left of us, behind us, before us. Stretch out your hands to bring your great salvation, your great power, your great might to everyone around. Stretch out your hands to destroy the work of the enemy. As Michael the Archangel said it, we say it today, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord rebuke you, Satan. Father, we love you today, and we ask you right now, acknowledging, Lord Jesus, you are here, you are present, your presence is unbroken, unceasing. We surrender, we yield. Holy Spirit, we love you, we yield. And God, grant your gifts, grant your revival, come and just clothe this place in great power. In Jesus' name, everybody says, amen. You can be seated, amen. Now listen, I come to you from a strange background that you have in the past with me, and I shared this last night. I'll do it quickly here. You know, in 1975, there was a 19-year-old kid dabbling in the occult, dabbling in the dark side, you know, fighting in bars and drinking and being an acid head and doing everything else into the 60s and the beginning of the 70s. All this stuff was going on in this kid's life. He didn't know where else to go. Wasn't raised in church. Didn't know this. No one touched him with the power of God. No one brought Jesus to him. Wasn't raised at all in any kind of church whatsoever. Didn't know, but maybe a verse of scripture somehow, some way, he heard somewhere, but didn't know a thing. Understood that God was there, but God was not here. And he was in a great search in his life. In the end of those teenage years, that young kid got into Buddhism and went to a temple, and the temple master said, go passive and meditate and reach the ascended masters, and if they come near you, let them come into you because they'll bring you great wisdom. In the context of that week, everything was going on in my life as a 19-year-old kid, and I was on the edge of hell itself. I was on the edge. I knew that. I knew that I was lost. I knew that I did not know God. I had great fear in my life, but I was grasping at something until somebody, as I said yesterday, had the guts,
Somebody had the spiritual guts. Somebody had such a compelling love for the lost because of their salvation and them being clothed with the Spirit of God. They came into my party on a Friday night. Acid heads, drug heads, pot heads, drinking. The walls were vibrating with metal music. Everything was packed out. People laying on the grass outside, upstairs, every single room of the house. And one man, totally saved, totally transformed, 2 weeks old in the Lord, walked into the apartment and cleared the house. He cleared the house. When he walked into the door, a brightness and a shining, and everybody looked, and he began to witness one by one to everybody in the apartment, everybody in the blazing, pothead and acid head and drug head party was going on. He began to witness to everybody. Nobody stopped him. Nobody looked around. Everybody just set their drugs down. They began to set their beers down. They began to do everything else and run. I ran. I hid from him. I was afraid. You know, when you've got darkness in you and you are lost and you have nothing else to do, but maybe put your life on the edge of hell itself, then when light comes and light strikes that darkness, we all ran. Darkness was running all over the place. One singular, two-week-old, saved, spirit-filled, empowered believer walked into a party like that, and that's where he unleashed the gospel on me. He unleashed the gospel in such a way that I ran from him, went home. That night, the gospel, all of a sudden, I'm sitting there. I didn't know about the Spirit of God convicting of sin, righteousness, and judgment. I didn't know anything about that other than that I was engaged. I was encountered. I was struck. I was struck by the hand of God. And I only knew one thing to do in the middle of the night in my basement of my mom and dad's house, just to get off my bed, get on my knees. Here again, you got a kid that didn't know anything, and this kid didn't understand anything about God, never prayed, never been in a church service like this. This probably would have scared me. I probably would have loved it, but it would have scared me because I was in the darkness. I was sitting in the darkness. I was doing the stuff. But the Spirit of God convicted and spoke, and that night, you know what I did? I just simply rolled out of my bed, and I just said, Jesus, I don't know everything about you, but what these guys have told me, that you would come into my life, that you would save me, that you would give me your power, that you would change my life, that you would deliver me. I just knew all these things that the guy said. And I said, Jesus, come in. And I want you to know that I had a Cornelius experience that night. I mean, God came in. The power of the Spirit came in. God manifested his power. And I tell you what, I was utterly changed. And I closed my eyes talking to Jesus. And all I could do is see myself standing up in front of crowds, preaching Jesus to everybody, pleading for people to come to Christ. I didn't know what a preacher was. I didn't know what a rabbi was. I didn't know what a priest was. You should have seen in the beginning. I didn't know where to buy a Bible. I didn't know there was a Christian bookstore. So I went to Kmart, Blue Light Special, first Bible. I got that Bible. I began to read. I began to do everything with that Bible. Where do you start as a late 60s, early 70s pothead, acid head, crazy man that just got saved, and all that mattered was Jesus was alive and I was delivered and I was ready to go. I ran to my mom. I ran to my dad. I ran to my brothers. They thought I was nuts. There was so much joy and so much peace like a river. It didn't matter. I mean, all I knew was to tell him and tell him and tell him and tell all my friends. Half of all of my friends in 2 weeks got saved. Like dominoes, one by one, they'd either run from us like I ran from the first guy, Steve. They would either run for a while or they would get saved on the spot. It was an astounding time, and I've had over 39 years on the field now, and I've got to see thousands come to Christ all over the place. I've gotten to see some of the neatest things over the years. It has been really quite extraordinary to see the utter, absolute, infallible faithfulness of Jesus Christ in my life and the Spirit of God's work in the context of the battle for the souls of humanity is what it's all about. And so all these years, I've seen the hand of God come. I've seen the salvations come. I have seen in locations the power of God come in such a way to level the crowds and put them on their faces on the ground. where silence in the presence of God went on for 2 hours. A man stood up and finally said, "Be still and know that I'm God." Another wave of God's power just literally leveled everybody in the place, and everybody sat there for another hour weeping in the powerful, powerful presence of God that was absolutely, I felt that if I would have opened my eyes, I would have seen God face to face. That powerful presence, that powerful revival was so astounding in that place. Just struck everybody. And that went on for hours that night. And all of a sudden, the next night, people began to show up and everybody showed up in the place. That went on for 6 hours. And the next night, 6 hours. And by the fourth night, they had to tell everybody that's been blessed, everybody that's been absolutely incredibly blessed in the last couple of days, get out. Because the people outside can't get in, so let them come in and get engaged by the hand of God. It was incredible. Over the years, I've seen so many things like this, but I'm going to tell you that I have also seen, in 35 years of doing deliverance, hundreds and hundreds of deliverances, listening to the demons through a little 5-year-old, through an 18-year-old, through a 50-year-old, through hundreds of others, scream and mock God and curse. You know, we began to do this in the 70s. We were really plunged into it in the 80s. And as we saw this, I want you to hear me right now. I know the presence of the enemy. I have seen, I've watched, I've seen the devastation in lives. I've seen powerful demons throw people to the ground, distort their face, make languages come out of their mouths. I've seen the rise of this, the incredible rise of demon possession, like Mark chapter 5. I've seen the numbers become so big and so broad that we can't even get to everybody that cries for help. One of the last phone calls I got on our emergency line was from Croatia, and this is all it said: Ross, many demonized people in Croatia, please come to Croatia. My grandmother and grandfather were born in Croatia, and they came from Dalmatia and came to the United States in 1919. So I have a Croatian, Macedonian call sooner or later. We got to France, we got to Germany, we got to Poland, but I haven't gotten to Croatia yet. Pray for us to get to Croatia. Because in Croatia, in Russia, in Germany, in France, in the United States, in Pennsylvania, there are demonized individuals across the board. Children are being demonized. Children are being ritualized. It is unprecedented what I'm seeing. And my response to it is urgency and outrage. Urgency and outrage in the face of darkness, as the scripture and the Spirit of God has spoken that we will have unprecedented demonic presence, unprecedented possessions and works and counterfeit signs, wonders, and miracles, unprecedented as we come to the end of the days. The Word of God has given warning. The Word of God has given intel. The Word of God has prepped the church if the church has been listening to the Spirit of the Lord. In the context of that, in the ministry that we do with satanic ritual abuse and underground, and we decided in 1980, 81, 82, that when we heard the stories, they were so bizarre, underground things, covens, blood-soaked rituals and all the rest. We decided to form a team and go after it. We decided that we are going to go and we're going to hunt this down. We didn't know the Ezekiel 8 at that time. I didn't really understand the Ezekiel 8, study it. I didn't really, really needed to look back in the Old Testament to see the constant demonization and human sacrifice among the tribes that constantly attacked Israel that was going on. And that brought me into law enforcement, that brought me into, you know, investigative stuff, that brought me into understanding that we needed God's power to go, you know, into places to go to find victims and extract them and bring them to safe houses. The sheer numbers of satanic ritual abuse, we're not going to go over all that this morning, but I'm going to tell you we're in the millions in the United States. We're estimating 40 million first generation all across the world right now. What we hear about, and listen, I'm going to tell you right now that it's critical mass. You know, and what I look at right now, listen, I look and what I see, I am concerned for the sake of the world. And for the untrained, unempowered, we can call it Sardis or Laodicean, the church that is absolutely sleeping in the midst of the battle. It is an outrage. It is a dereliction of duty. It is an embarrassment. And the dark side loves it. They love the suppression. They love to suppress and cripple and harm and silence the body of Christ. I believe the enemy hated what he saw today in this place. I believe that when there is such praise and such prayer and such unleashing, that the enemy not only is backed off, but he'll look. He'll look for ways. In some of your lives, you're going to know some of the past issues here that have happened and that still affect you, where the enemy has doorways. Now, I'm showing you a picture quickly here because we have a lot of concerns and a lot of things on our plate. Some of the team that I brought with me, some of your friends here in this church took us to some places in this little city area where there may have been rituals and other stuff going on, because we prayer mapped your area. Let me tell you about Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania is one of the highest concentrations of satanic ritual abuse, the ancient brotherhood, going all the way back to the 1950s. We've been from Erie, Pennsylvania to Lititz, Pennsylvania, and all in between. I've been into Pennsylvania in the last 22 years over 160 times. I have gone from one side to the other side in my car, sometimes by myself, just putting on praise music, praying, crying, weeping over this state, because of the victims that have come, because of what we know, digging up bones in Erie, Pennsylvania, taking it back to police academies, dealing with victims all over the place. 100 of Pennsylvania SRAs have come to us, ritually abused have come to us. And so we plunged a prayer map intercession for the last 22 years into Pennsylvania. God strike the dark side. God, you know, bless the churches. God bring revival. God raise churches up. God, and so for 22 years, we've got investment into your state by the Spirit of God, because the underbelly, the secret power of lawlessness, this mystery of iniquity is really real, and it's really operative, and it all begins in childhood with satanic ritual abuse. And in this state alone, there are tens of thousands now to the fourth generation, from 68 all the way down to four-year-olds, put in rituals, brutally in trauma, split and programmed and altered in their personalities, and demonized and used. I'm going to tell you that in Pennsylvania, on the underbelly of things, they have been here, they have entrenched themselves. There's not a city, not a holler, not a little place, not a big city, not a place in Pennsylvania that we've been that we haven't found the victims. That means there's a coven. That means there's those who are summoning demons, no different than in the Old Testament with Moloch and Chemosh and Nebo and the rest. Their methodology is to stay hidden and cloaked and operate until their time comes. Their method is to infiltrate the church and send people in and to observe churches and want to summon and send powers. Why does the body of Christ, why is it experiencing so much more warfare? Why is it experiencing a silencing and a suppression in churches that aren't ready to engage? Let me tell you what, fear is a great tool of the enemy. Fear is a great place. All the enemy has to do is simply cause the fear to bring the passivity, to shove into silence the body of Christ, and we grieve the Spirit of God, and we quench the Holy Spirit, and we silence all the work of God, and then the atmosphere around the city becomes oppressive and dark, and the drug trade comes, and the human trafficking trade comes, and the poverty comes, and the darkness comes, and it's affecting the entire city. Cities are affected by who is really in predominant, you know, control of a local area. Stephen walked into Samaria. It was covered with the high power, a priest, and the high and the low were all into it. But one man walking into the city, unleashing the gospel of the kingdom, saved, healed, delivered, and the city was full of joy. The atmosphere changed. Little boy that you're seeing right there is from Allentown, Pennsylvania. Been on our prayer network for years, and we've traveled to Allentown eventually. Allentown, little Lewis here was abducted in 1994 right off the streets. The reason we know is sitting in my office in Akron comes a person that came out of satanic ritual abuse and rituals and flies to Akron and somehow shows up at our offices. And they show up at our offices to tell me about the rituals that were done and where they were done and who did them. When they named the priests, the coven name of the priest, that got our attention. Our staff began to listen, and we listened to them. They took us to the place. They began to tell us about how they, in the preparation of rituals, if you understand the underground, when they abduct individuals or they have people, there's a holding of individuals in preparation all the way to the time of sacrifice. This little boy right here in Allentown was brought to Akron, Ohio, according to the eyewitness, brought into a house that we've located. And there at that house, the girl was sexually used in a sex ritual and brutally used. The little boy was sexually harmed and was sacrificed in a human sacrifice and eaten in the end. This has bothered me along with other cases for so long. The decision has been, we're not giving up on it until we engage the perpetrators who have never been nailed. This little boy right here had a family and was just out on the streets playing. He's one of many that have been abducted. If you think in terms of what's going on in the world around us, 27 to 127 million in human trafficking and or satanic ritual abuse trafficking on a global scale. Where kids in this area, all across Pennsylvania, by the millions across the United States and by the tens of millions around the world that are taken in, on the one hand, in human trafficking used sexually over and over and over and over again. And the ritual abuse is even a step down from that, where the dark powers are summoned and used, and the altering of their lives continue. When I begin to look at the stats, when I begin to hear the calls, when I've seen the faces of the victims for years and years and years, when I've seen powerful demons speak through individuals and look at me and know my name before I said a word. Look at me, and a demon said, "Didstar, we have fought you before." I stood in front of the officer that the demon's speaking through. His wife is there, a soldier's over here, and a demon speaks to him, shaking his head uncontrollably and shaking his face and speaking these words. I want you to understand that demons are as absolutely real as they were in Scripture. My name is Legion, for we are many. Remember? In the book of Acts, Paul we know and Jesus we know, but who are you? And the ones that were not saved, the ones that did not have the Spirit of God, the ones that were not covered by the blood of the Lamb, they were in big trouble. If you are here and God is on the outside and God is not on the inside, you are in grave danger in your life. Danger because your sin abides. Hell's rights, Satan's rights all abide over you. It's as plain and it's as simple, and if you've been arguing for years and debating with your family and debating with others and somebody's dragged you here today, then I'm glad they've dragged you here to hear one more time. There's one that loves you like no one else. There's one that knows you better than anybody else. There's one that desires you more than anyone else, and that is Jesus Christ. There's one that can save you. Outside of him, you are lost and your sins remain, and the devil has rights. And any believer that opens the door, that gives the enemy the rights, the same aspect of going passive and yielding. You know, be angry, but don't sin. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. And don't give the devil the foothold. Don't give him the right. Don't go to the psychic. Don't open the Ouija board. You know, don't get to the tarot cards. Watch out on the music, watch out on the television, watch out on the movies, watch out on many other things. Watch out, because there's charged objects and charged demonized books, and there's so much of it now that the body of Christ, in some quadrants, I believe, think that the dark side is like glass, so big, so loud, so humongous, so overarching. And in some ways, it seems like that when you don't know the other side of the fence. when you don't really understand that Jesus Christ, the hero of humanity on the cross, the devastating work. See, he comes to love us. He comes to save us. He comes with the work of God. I call it the physics of God, because he's going to come and he's conquered sin. He's going to conquer death. He's going to conquer our separation from God. He's going to conquer the issue of dying and rotting in a grave. He's going to provide for us indestructible, irreversible immortality and the ability to see God face to face because of the blood of the Lamb. Because on a hill far away, at an old rugged cross, right? They call it the emblem of what? Suffering and shame. You're absolutely right. God did this in the sight, not just because of sin. 1 John 3:8. The very reason the Son of God appeared, manifested, was to destroy the devil's work. Take a look a little bit here as we look. What time is it right now concerning the prophetic realm? Look at what's going on. The Russians in Ukraine and Syria and Iran, Israel, North Korea, China, Islam, terrorism, Ebola, chemical, biological, infectious virus, plague, environmental, the comets, the dirty nukes, the invasion, civil war possibly in places all over, economic, cyber terrorism. And you begin to level, you know, all these things that we hear about in the news. It's almost like the movie The Wizard of Oz, lions and tigers and bears, oh my. And I think sometimes we don't know the scripture and what it says concerning the end of days and what it tells us what's going to be happening in the days. We as believers sometimes are like deer caught in the headlights and we stand astounded. I don't stand astounded because of what is going on. Jesus made it very clear in Matthew 24 as the days of Noah. He made it very clear concerning don't let anybody deceive you. Earthquakes and famines and wars and nation rise against nation. Wickedness will abound in such a way that it's going to drive the majority to grow cold. He talks about unprecedented times, that there is nothing in all of history that will look like what's coming upon the earth in the years to come. What's here now? What's in the underbelly? What's rising all around us? What time is it right now? What does it spell out for us in as far as being a believer? Making sure that not only we're right with God. Listen, why does it take us so long to understand? Getting right with God is one aspect. But the other side of this whole picture of being right, it's not walking on a tightrope. You know, just saying, I just want to be right with God. I just don't want to fall into sin. You know what I want? I want more than that. I want the power of God. I want the joy of the Lord. I want to be able to be used in ministry and see the thousands come and the hundreds delivered and the hand of God shake and the power of God to come down to level hundreds for hours and days with his visitation. I believe that the issues that we see in the world around us are all caused supernaturally. Globalism and the political ideology, our own nation and the crumbling and the corruption and the absolute disgust of what we see in the political realm is all, there's a backdrop of our battle here is not against flesh and blood. There's real powers operative that are shaping the world. Revelation 12, the dragon, Satan, is leading the whole world astray. It's not a surprise to me. It's not a surprise the UN spirituality is based on some of the deepest, darkest doctrines of demons. It's not a surprise to me that this spiritual dark side has pumped itself into military vision, economic acquisition. It's not a surprise to me to see the dismantling and the deterioration and the destabilization all around us. It's part of what God has said through the Spirit of God in prophecy is going to be happening all around us. On the day of Pentecost, and you know Pentecost well, do you not? Anybody know the power of the Spirit of God? Well, listen, on the day of Pentecost, if you remember, Peter stood up and said, you know, listen to me. Look how bold that was. And he says, because all that was going on, he says, this, you're seeing the power of the Spirit of God. You heard the sound, the tongues of fire, the languages that are coming with the praises of God. This is that which the prophet Joel spoke about hundreds of years ago. Prophecy is so real. Prophecy is infallible. 1,000 prophecies in scripture, over half of them have been fulfilled, and another 400 and some yet to be fulfilled. The biggest ones in human history are yet to be fulfilled. And out of those that are left to be fulfilled, the majority speak about what the dark side is going to do in a sequential level in the world, what the dark side is going to do when the restrainer is removed and the Antichrist is released. Billions die. It's almost an extinction level events in the last of the 7 years. It's almost an environmental extinction level events. The abyss is open. The Antichrist is here. The wrath of the Antichrist and all the rest. And as we look at the building up of that, we need to realize that before it all breaks out, before even that we are all out of here, all of this rise around us continues right now. In this holler, our team and your friends in this church took us to a place where it was said which lived and maybe dark things occurred. That's what we do that when we go into cities. We prayer map them. We want to find out. We want to find the victims. You know what we've done back in the 80s? We simply prayed, Lord, because of deliverance and dealing with demons, we finally said, Lord, just lead to us who's ever demonized in the city, because it seems like 99% of the churches won't touch this. I apologize, Lord, but 99% of the churches won't touch this. And all of a sudden, we began to get everybody. This is what trained us. This is what, going to every scripture, reading materials, going to conferences, that's one thing. But all of a sudden, we're having people every week, every week, every week, every week, until the little offices that we had that had six other offices upstairs and then some downstairs, there would be nights that every one of our pastors or workers or leaders would have a demonized person in every single office and demonized people waiting in the waiting room for their turn. There are times we'd leave that office at 4 o'clock in the morning, astounded of the side of the darkness and how real, but rejoicing because of the power of God, the liberation that Jesus brings, and seeing instantly these oppressed and demonized and harmed individuals liberated instantly, and joy and light and the presence of God and salvation. So let me share with you today that this is a day in which we need to make it very, very clear that we stand up at some point in this service to say that we are going to defy the spirit of fear, that we're going to end any concept of fear in our lives. I'm going to tell you, after 30 years, 35 years, I've had Satanists come right into the church, right to the front area, and tell me, as I'm holding my 2-year-old little daughter, we're coming to steal your daughter, we're going to slice her up, we're going to use her in a ritual because we told you too much, and the only way I'm going to get my rank back is to steal your daughter, we're coming for her. You know, we have knives, and the big issues are spit and cussing. That's the big thing when sometimes demonized people are unleashed. We've seen so many things over the years, and we can tell you story after story after story. But I'd rather tell you story after story after story over 30 years, Psalm 91, and the hand of God, the protection of God, the authority of the Lord, the demons screaming when you mention the cross, mention the name of Jesus, and acknowledge the blood of the Lamb, knowing that they don't care about Quetzalcoatl, they don't care about Muhammad, they don't care about Buddha, they're all part of that side. The dark side is powerful, deceptive, and superhuman as they are, as predators on the human race, are absolutely stunned and shake and are in fear and are absolutely in every way do not want to engage anyone that knows the authority and the power of the living Christ. It's true. I have seen the protection of the Lord. I've seen the hand of God. I've seen God just step in and deliver us and providentially, and again, story after story after story of the hand of God. And so let me just tell you, after 35 years of being in places where we're digging up bones in Pennsylvania in a ritual site where we're not sure we're being targeted by weapons because the Brotherhood is there, and they don't like that we've done what we've done up there in other places. The phone calls and death threats and blood things and blood and bones sent to our home, to our offices in mail, curses, hexes and curses and spells and oh my, you know? But we've learned all the way back in the 80s, and when God was teaching us in Scripture about targeting and using the authority of Christ, This is why it's so astounding to me that if we're the body of Christ and we believe, ask, you'll receive, seek, you'll find, knock, and the door will be open. If we absolutely believe in the power of prayer, then why in most of the churches all over the place is the average 18 seconds? Thank you, Lord, for the beginning of the service. Thank you, Lord, for the offering. Thank you, Lord, for the end of the service. And it's done. Acts chapter 4, the entire body stood up, raised their voices to God in prayer, and they unleashed intercession. Why not the bodies of Christ standing up collectively by the millions across the United States, and they could and they should, you know, lifting up intercession, praying for the cities, praying for the salvation of souls? Do we see anybody weep for the souls of men anymore? Do we see the body of Christ literally weep for the souls of men anymore? In a critical time, the day in which the dark side is breathing down the necks of humanity and breathing down the neck of the end of history. It is as if believers think that God has disappeared, that God has gone silent, that his power isn't great. And that outrages me. And I believe that outrages heaven. And I believe that when Jesus saw in the temple the selling and all the stuff that was going on, instead of the place of prayer, zeal for the house of God, the house of prayer, consumed him. Consumed him. And he went into action. In your state, in the United States, 27 million, 40 million, human trafficking, satanic ritual abuse, the underground, outraged. It should consume us for the evangelization of our nation. Don't put your trust in some politician. Don't put your trust in some politician today as the ultimate end. It is the revivals that come. It is the God striking the areas that even strike the cities. Our hope is in the living Christ and his power operative through the churches in your life. The only hope that Samaria had was one man, Philip, a young man that the church was scattered and everything was going crazy. But instead of hiding, instead of going somewhere else, instead of fear, gripping him and paralyzing him, he launched into a city by himself. I want you to know there's a lot of things you can do by yourself. I want you to know there's places you can be. Listen, it's great to be in the crowd. I love taking teams. We have teams. They went out. I told you, they went out last night. I get a note last night, and they went to a place where there are all kinds of snake skins and all kinds of other stuff. And I called my wife early in the day, and she said she's praying. We've got difficulties. I got heavy difficulties back home. She says, I'm praying, and all I see is snakes. And so last night, we're at a place where there's snake skins all over the place. So I get a note from the team that comes with me that says, hey, we'll meet you at the church in the morning. We're getting up at 7 o'clock because one had a vision about a little girl. We're going to go back to this place, and we're going to check it out. We're going to look around. So all morning I've been thinking about it. I sure hope nobody gets bit by a snake. I'm praying against snakes biting any of the team that was out this morning. They're all here. They're all fine. They're in the service. But they are out hunting based on what they felt God showed them concerning a little girl and concerning the possibility of rituals here in the area. Supernatural causes of the end of days, they are real critical issues. If you look at Matthew 24, if you look at 1 Timothy 4, 1, if you look at 2 Thessalonians 2, if you look at 1 John chapter 2 or the entire book of Revelation, the backdrop to the political, the economic, the environmental, the military, the backdrop to the violence, to the wars and all the rest, there is a spiritual engagement. We know about the origins of Satan, the nature of Satan, the method of Satan, but most of us don't understand the agenda. And most of the prophetic scripture reveals the sequential agenda that Satan's going to bring into the world, the progressive work that he's going to build throughout the world until the time comes when the restrainer is removed and then all hell is literally released in the world for about 7 years until the return. Just as there is no advance to the kingdom of God without the power of God, there is no advance to Satan's kingdom without powers. The real threat analysis is from biblical intel, not intelligence agencies, not futurologists in their forecast centers, definitely not from Nostradamus, Edgar Casey, Sylvia Brown, and all the other liars guided by spirit guides, demons. The unprecedented global events in the future are going to be far beyond anything the world's ever seen. When I look at biblical prophecy, it teaches me this. It teaches me that all these things are going to be occurring. God in his hand is with us to the very end in the midst of all of it. The concern is for the world. I'm not going to sit back afraid. I'm not going to sit back astounded, because we know the answer. When the rest of the world is saying, what in the world is going on around here? Look, do you see what's happening to our kids? You see what's going on the television? You see what's happening in the news? You see what's happening in Israel? You see what's happening in all the world around us? Look what's going on. And everybody's like, we don't know why. Why is it? And everybody's just, you know, even politicians, they're all just in a quandary, or they're part of it. Biblical prophecy teaches us that the dark spirits, the demons, will be here in unprecedented numbers. Now, the Spirit of God expressly, the Greek word definitively, clearly, with a clarion voice, says that in the latter times, some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits. Greek word planos, seducing, deceiving imposters. They will come in unprecedented numbers, and they'll lead people to write doctrines of demons. Revelation 18, 2, we read about the future, not all here, but developing. Babylon is developing. And he cried mightily with a loud voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen. Now that's a declaration of victory in the end, but the culmination is in the next verse. And that Babylon on a global scale has become the dwelling place of demons and a prison for every foul spirit, a cage for every unclean and hateful bird, in reference to the dark side. The manifestation of spirits, demons in lives, in cities, in families, in places, are going to become unprecedented. If you understand your authority and you're willing to do the work of God, in many ways, we've been saying this for the last couple of weeks, it's going to be like OK Corral. In a lot of ways, it's going to be like a shootout in the end. Because if you're involved in evangelism at all, you're going to engage people that all of a sudden the Spirit's going to come up and look at you and say, we will kill you. And, you know, how they speak. And they're going to do stuff like that. Intimidation, whatever else. Their goal always to mock God, scream, and whatever else. And we just simply learned that Jesus said, I have given you authority to tread on these. So we just simply learned that we're allowed to, by that authority, look at them. I don't have to yell any longer. In the beginning, you know, you yell and you stomp and whatever else. But I realized that in all of this, especially with little five-year-old demonized people, where the demon throws them to the ground and the demon is speaking and mocking and using every single curse word you could possibly conceive and cursing God. Silence! In the name of Jesus. And all of a sudden, they're frozen. They are silenced. Their mouths are shut. If you understand the ground level of your authority in Jesus, silence. How'd you get in? Because you want to make sure they close the doors. Ultimate issue in Jesus, ekbalo, get out. Make sure you get all of them out. You're going to have more and more that you're going to have to deal with. More and more demonized people, charged, empowered. Many because they want to be. The underground by the thousands and thousands, the satanic, the traditional side, the popular side, the non-traditional side, the Santeria, Paulo Mayombe, all of the other side, voodoo and hoodoo and cantabile, and you can just go on and on and on. New age practitioners and channelers and remote viewers and astral projectors, they want these powers. They have no ability to discern what they are. They have no idea that Satan is able to masquerade, Greek word, metaskizmazetai. They have the physics to morph their appearance and approach without changing their nature or purpose. And so hundreds of millions around the world are gripped by masquerading spirits and the false teaching. Anybody have sleep paralysis? Something comes in your room, presses you down. All of a sudden you're paralyzed. Fear is there. You know something sat on your bed. Something begins to even speak to you. By the thousands and thousands and thousands across this nation around the world, people are experiencing. By the millions, people have come to learn astral projection. Every satanic, ritually abused individual that we've ever met in 30-some years has the ability by demon empowerment to leave their body and astral out, and they've learned how to bring attack to believers. They have learned how to bring engagement. They understand how to do curses and spells and rituals and summoning and sending. We have all around us, and you have in this city, I believe, charged sites. Maybe not this big. Charged sites. You have in the world that we're living in technology, sciences, transhumanism that seems to be scientific, but they've joined up with Russian cosmists and occultists, and they've joined together to say that the ancient gods in the sky are now going to be guiding the scientists so that they can obtain immortality and develop an evolutionary process in humanity and help us to become gods. Remind you of Genesis 3? Transhumanism, on that stage in New York City, the world's top scientists, inventors, geneticists, theoretical physicists sat there, and in the red, you're going to see gurus or Russian cosmists, the occultists that are engaging the principalities and powers and conjuring and drawing them, and they're the ones declaring that those entities will help the scientists to bring about immortality. Because the declaration is they're not going to need God. They're going to become gods. And they are completely seized with the deception that the fallen cherub brought in Genesis 3. The charged skies, alien skies, should have heard LA yesterday just absolutely railing against the alien agenda. You got to understand how hundreds of millions around the world now are believing in and engaging in the Vatican and the false, you know, religion and so forth is embracing all of it. And by the tens of millions and millions upon millions, you're going to have people that are talking about seeing them, engaging them, abductions, talking to them. And what are they? Ephesians 6 talks about our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. The Greek words are cosmocrator, arche, the porneus pneumonikai, the exousia. They are the species of the demons, the different types with different functions. And they operate from the sky down in the epihuranos, in the heavenly realms, and they're operating down, and they're leading the world in tremendous deception and tremendous seduction. Pharmakon, drugs. Pharmakia, in prophecy, pharmakia, the drugs that are inseparably connected to demon worship will become a global grip of billions of individuals that will not repent in the end of days. In Mexico, 100,000 dead in the drug wars. What the FBI has learned lately is not all of those are just drug lords killing others and other drug runners. When their hearts are missing, when ritual symbols are used, that much of it is rituals that are done to the saint of death, Santa Muerte, to conjure powers to bless the drug trade and to send the drug trade worldwide. In the context, in ritual and in violence, 100,000 dead south of the border. Charged dark fantasies. Anybody hear of Slender Man? Two girls so believing in Slender Man take their girlfriend out and stab, stab, stab. Another girl so believing in Slender Man dresses up a little bit like Stab's mom. Slender Man, the author of Slender Man, where does he live? Erie, Pennsylvania. An archetype, or is this like doctrines of demons, and this is what I believe, inspiring an individual in fantasy writings and actually depicting the actual demon and its presence so that when kids read dark fantasy, spiritual attachment can occur and begin to intertwine in their minds. And they will do things that moms say later, that was not my child. You're right. It was a demon they opened the door to that maybe you allowed and you weren't aware enough to make sure they didn't have their hands on gateways to the dark side. High ancient places, that's in the United States. Semiramis, one of the most ancient kinds of rituals, a human sacrifice on American soil. And presidents and senators and media moguls and military men in California next to the Russian River have been doing this for years. Nephilim sites around the world reopened. I believe 500 million blood rituals have been occurring all over the place. Well, enough. Say this with me, enough. Enough of the dark side. Can you stand just for a moment while I'm doing this? Just stand for a moment, please, with me. I just want you to join with me in this, if you want to say it out loud. I am outraged by the presence of the dark side, by what it's doing to our children, doing in our neighborhoods, in our families, and what it's done to my life. I defy the enemy in the name of Jesus. The Spirit of God dwells in me. I name the name of Christ. I acknowledge the blood of the Lamb. I receive the authority Christ gives. The Lord rebuke you, Satan. I will not stand for this. And I will not back away. I will not back down. In the name of the Lord Jesus, for the sake of souls, for the sake of the little ones, and the honor of the Lord Jesus Christ. Stand just for a moment with me, okay? Because I want to go over a few of these, and I really want you to join with me in some of it. In this, I've called this the five A's, and I think these are foundational. Because across the land in the last 5 years, and thousands of people over 50-some conferences, here's what we learned. Most Christians do not understand awareness, being alert on a spiritual basis. They didn't know about the authority of Christ. 90% didn't understand the authority of Jesus. How are you going to use it if you don't know it? 60-70% said they knew about the armor of God. When I said, do you know that you have it on right now? The hands went down to about 20-30%. The majority of the body of Christ don't even consciously have on the armor of God. And then there's simply the stepping out in the action that we see in the book of Acts. Listen, I'm going to take a lot of your time, so go ahead and sit down. I'm going to take a little bit more time here this morning. We're okay with that? Because I want you to hear clearly. I mean, we're going to get up and we're going to stand up in a few moments, and we're going to clear the house. We're going to clear our past. We're going to clear the present. We're going to clear the house in a sense. We're going to stand on the side of the Lord, and we're going to see what God's going to do in the midst of this. And some that may need deliverance, some that may need freedom, some that maybe have deep wounds, and the healing of the Lord Jesus is going to come here today and minister to you. And some that are here by infiltration. You've seen it on the web. You're simply here to spy out what's being done today. We in the body of Christ welcome you. And we love you as a fellow human being. You're in grave danger if you're on that side of the fence and if you are a trained infiltrator. If you're from the ancient brotherhood and you are here and you know your hands have blood, then this day, mark it, you're hell bound. Judgment comes. Even your demons know this. That's why they're not here challenging anything. The five A's. Awareness. How many are aware that there's anywhere from 27 million to maybe 130 million worldwide in the area of human trafficking and satanic ritual abuse numbers? It's unprecedented, isn't it? How many understood in Pennsylvania that in every single city, every single holler, every single place, satanic ritual abuse victims are present now for over 35 years? How many have understood that in every single city in the United States, and we have a project called Project Confirm, this is boots on the ground 30-some years, every city in the United States has the ancient kind of coven that Ezekiel chapter 8 speaks about, operative, purposely placed, just like Masonic temples, purposely placed 56,000 of them in the United States, with some of the most cutting edge or really literally ancient of Egyptian and other ritual format languages and symbols of some of the deepest occultism. On a visible scale, the Masonic temples, 56,000 are here, and we don't even know. There's people that debate whether that's an occult issue or whether that's are they part of the kingdom of God. Please understand, when you read the writers that are behind the Masonic temple and the Masons behind all of this, when I read Albert Pike, he tells me that Lucifer is the one they're engaged with, that chaos in a new order, that Jesus is nothing. Don't try to convince me that it's just a nice societal thing. You've been deceived. You've been lied to. You've been drawn in. And if you've done an oath, even as a Christian, Christians down south have been invited to come in, and they're doing a big recruiting across the nation. They've been invited to come in. They just do a little blindfold, and here's what they're going to say to you. They're going to say, well, just acknowledge you're in the darkness, and that when we take this off and you do a few other things, that you're going to come into the Masonic light. Masonic light is Luciferic. It is the opposition of the spirit of God and the spirit of the Lord in your life. And so come out and leave it today and renounce it and repent before the Lord if you've been drawn in. Maybe out of ignorance, maybe out of being unaware. Many even believers have been unaware and gone to a psychic at one point. It's really unbelievable, isn't it? Many have gone and dabbled or touched or got on the edge of dark things, and they haven't been assured. So when we read in 2 Corinthians 2:11, Paul says, we are not ignorant, right? That verse, we're not ignorant of his devices. That little word right there means that we are not willfully, in other words, Paul's saying, we, by choice, are not willfully choosing to be ignorant of the devil's schemes, of his devices. He was acknowledging this is a good thing. Don't be ignorant. You know, I've heard over the years people say when we mention the devil, mention something like this, they simply say, don't talk about the devil. That gives him glory. Did Jesus give him glory when he talked about him in Scripture? Does the Scriptures give the devil glory when it reveals him and shares? This is the only place to find the exact nature. This brings revelation to who he is. So when you have ignorance on top of ignorance, then you have a body of Christ that is completely unprepared. There are believers that don't know what hit them. Can I ask the honest question? How many times in your life you found out later, but you didn't know in the beginning that it was direct spiritual warfare and you got struck up? Anybody? In the beginning, you didn't know what it was? You found out later? Anybody think they know right now they're going through something and you didn't understand? It's spiritual warfare. You know, Job didn't know to the end. He didn't understand who was behind the physical attack, the causes of all those things that were going on. He didn't understand who it was. And I think we ought to become very, very literate biblically, very, very literate when it comes to the Word of God and an understanding and being very, very aware. Very aware in the concept of our own spiritual warfare, aware of our salvation, that we have been delivered, that we are now we're in the kingdom of His Son. We've been extracted from the dominion of darkness. Colossians chapter 1. That we stand in a whole new relationship, a whole new position. The devil loves illiterate believers. He can push them. He can do a lot of things that they're not simply aware of. That awareness will make you aware of what's around you in the area. And I'm going to say this. I believe awareness in the biblical sense, the foundation biblical, and then awareness that enables you to see what's really going on around, that it causes a sense of boldness, that it brings a sense of competence, that it brings a sense of confidence that you actually know what's really going on. The devil loves confusion. God's not the author of that, right? And I believe awareness, Holy Spirit, biblically lit eyes, awareness can save you a lot of trouble in your life and a lot of trouble in your family and a lot of trouble in a lot of other ways. Awareness. Are you aware? Are you aware of the biblical prophecies and what's to come? Are you willing to look? Ezekiel was willing to look when God said, I'm going to take you and open a supernatural hole and take you into the caverns, and you're going to see abominable things where human sacrifice is being done, and I'm going to take you all the way to the perpetrators that are doing it. And it was the 70 elders of Israel. By day, they were one thing. By night, they were in the temple and they were doing Lucifer. They were doing serpent worship right in and under in the caverns of the temple. Alert is another great word. I love the word gregoruo. Now, when I looked at all the Greek definitions of the word, one of the best came from Kenneth Wiest. He described this word as being an expression of that vigilance, that it's the opposite of passivity and silence. The idea here is that you're very vigilant, looking for the impending danger. Did anybody drive all the way to church, all the way here, with your eyes closed the entire time? You would have never made it. Christians are trying to walk powerfully, but many times with their eyes closed. Alert. You know where this word is given? It's given, first of all, in Colossians 4:2. Let me go back to Colossians 4:2, or that's one more ahead of us. Colossians 4:2, and I love this verse, and I believe every believer should have this in their life. First of all, the power of prayer in your life. The thanksgiving. So prayer and thanksgiving is a part of a lot of the churches. Part of everything we did here. But look what the Spirit of God says in the middle of this. You know, there's going to be this earnest praying going on. There's going to be this thanksgiving on over here. But in the middle of this, it's the word gregoruo, watch, vigilance. How do you do that? What is that related to? And that's why I'm going to go back to the other word here. Be sober. Vigilant, that is watching, that is looking for the impending danger. Because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him. Now look what the Spirit of God says. Peter's writing this. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift you as wheat, but I prayed for you that your faith would not fail. And all of a sudden, Satan jumps on all of them. The evidence is, did they see Satan walk in the room? No. Did they know there was a conversation going on when they're eating with the Lord Jesus? I mean, there they are. Jesus is right there. They could have said, hey, Jesus is here. Nothing's going to touch us. Don't think because it's a church building that Satan can't walk into your building. All it takes is one individual with a demon on their back walking into the building. Now, hopefully, you're and it seems very clear, you're clear enough that the demon is in trouble. We have people that have been demonized that have said they come to a local church, started to get out of their car, got very, very sick, threw up, felt something in their head say, don't go in there. We've had people, psychologists and officers and teachers, bring to us demonized people. Sometimes they just simply brought them in the room. Remember the story in the book of Acts? Jesus, we know, and Paul, we know. See, the demons know. They know whether you are a believer or not. They know you before you know or are aware of their presence. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked. Did anybody look up and say, when did that happen? To sift all of you as wheat. The Greek word plural, you, all of you guys. But I prayed, Greek word plural, all of you. I prayed for all of you that your faith would not fail. But look what happened in the beginning. When they got struck, evidence of warfare striking is they literally were scattered all over the place. Fear, scattered. Peter's eventually out there denying he knows the Lord and he's cussing. You better be clear that when you've got agitation, everything's being scrambled around you and you feel like just cussing about all of it, you can be very clear the enemy's right around the corner shoving it your way. And when you understand that the authority Christ gave you is not just to rebuke the demons on the ground in a person, but in the air right around you, you will learn how to clear the air around your own life in minutes. Instead of being oppressed 5 days, in 5 minutes by using that authority. Stop this. If you're aware, if you understand, and you just feel it, stop this. You know what believers do many times? They don't know what to do. Reading scriptures to demons does make them mad. They don't like it. Singing a song does maybe shove them back a little bit, get them away. And it's not because of how you sound. It's the words of the hymns and the presence of the Spirit of God in it. But when you all of a sudden, with the authority given to you, stop it. You have the right to order them. You have the right to say, shut up. You're not going to throw up. Don't throw them to the ground. You will not harm them. Silence. Now, we learned a lot of times the hard way in the beginning. We got puked on, spit on, cursed out, listened to them mock God. That bugged me the most. But when we really understood authority, it was silence. But I want you to know that awareness on a large biblical scale and being alert, practicing it. Coming here last night, coming back there in the middle of worship team, if I was called to go back and start a church, I'm going to say, come over. Come over, praise team. I love you. Thank you. Amen. Such a vital part in the intercession. But in the context of the intercession and the worship, there's just a part of me. The sense of looking around, awareness, the sense of alertness, the sense of somebody saying, Holy Spirit, is there a demon in the room? Is there a demon on somebody? Is somebody oppressed? Is there something going on here? Show me that in the context of everything so that we can just simply help clear the air or get people ready for manifestation and deliverance. Awareness. Awareness. Continue earnestly in prayer. And we read that. Authority. Now, let's look at the scripture again. Behold, I give you authority to trample. Now, this is in the perfect tense in the Greek, meaning from the moment of salvation with the abiding result that right now in your life is authority. I have given you permanently authority. It dwells in you. If you're a believer, it dwells in you. Here's what 90% of most of the believers across the land did not understand. So I want to take the time. Because someone asked me one time, well, then how do you know you have that? How do you get that authority? Appropriation. Lord Jesus Christ, and you want to say it with me? You can do it. Lord Jesus Christ, I acknowledge today that you have given me this authority. I receive it. I know you've given it to me. And I commit my heart to using this. You've given it for mission to trample, to tread on the dark side and to overcome all the power of the enemy, and I acknowledge nothing will harm me. That's one singular verse. And believers that understand it, an 18-year-old believer that understood that, and we said, I'm not casting out the demon, you do it. They had to do it. There's times we take teams out to do soul winning, and I'm not going to lead all the souls as much as I'd like to. Trainee, you do this. Some people have come to me and they brought lines. We're in Montana. I sat on the stage and they formed a line. It went on for almost 5 hours. 100 people were being baptized over here, but the line was here, and this went on for hour after hour after hour after hour. I don't have any more authority than you do. None. No more authority. You have 100%, I have 100% of the authority Jesus gave. I may have done it hundreds and hundreds of times. And see, years ago, then I wanted to say, okay, Lord, if this authority is to strike the enemy, how far can we take this? In one of the last churches I pastored, can we rise in praise and worship and then unleash an intercession and then collectively use the authority to rebuke the powers of the enemy in the air and the air in the city and all around? Yes. Can I use that authority that when I feel oppression, just oppression around me, can I use that authority to rebuke and to command, get out and release? And if I feel a ritual has been done and something summoned and something sent, something pretty heavy, Holy Spirit makes us aware. I love Acts chapter 8 because Philip was able to do this. This guy was running to serve the Lord, running to win souls. He didn't have a stitch of fear as he went into a highly demonized city by himself. And I love in the context of this how it all begins. You know, part of this whole chapter is when it just simply says the Holy Spirit said, go over there and stand next to that man in that chariot. He was able to quote what the Spirit of God said. When it comes to deliverance, when it comes to things around you, when it comes to things in your house, you can say, Lord, you can ask for the Spirit of God to give you definitive insight. And sometimes you don't get that right away. Sometimes there's a battle going on. Sometimes, like Daniel, the prince of Persia is stopping and holding back angels that had been sent weeks ago. But I believe engaging in this kind of warfare prayer and prayer helps break open things, helps break what would and used to be weeks of oppression into minutes. And a deliverance comes. The armor of God you've shared, and I know that you've been taught this, and a truth and righteousness and preparation, salvation and faith and word of God and spirit empowered prayers. Now listen, how do you appropriate the armor of God? You accept by, you know, each one. I accept the truth, but I'm going to live in the truth. I accept the righteousness of Christ, but I'm going to live in the righteousness. I accept the peace that comes from the gospel, and I'm going to be prepared to witness and win. I accept all the depth of my salvation. Not everybody does. That's why the Spirit of God had to say in the book of Hebrews, don't neglect so great, so deep, so awesome a salvation. Don't neglect this. The armor of God, it all begins in Ephesians 6, verse 10. To be empowered by the mighty strength. Three distinct words. This means that manifesting you is going to be power and might and strength, and manifesting through you is going to be power and might and strength if you're going to put on the armor of God. So putting on the armor of God is one of the most incredible things concerning to have the awareness of the presence and the might and the strength of the Lord in your life, in your walk with the Lord. The last one we want to mention here is simply action. The action that we need to take. The action in soul winning, the action in prayer, the action in praise. You've done that this day. On a daily basis, meeting with God and putting up the prayers and putting up the praise and putting out the warfare and being prepped, launching out of the world as a missionary. That's what it's all about. It really is all about that. I will show you my faith by action. Do you really believe that tens of thousands can still be saved? Yes. Do you really believe that we can go out there and really in praying and saying, God, here we are as a church. We're prepped. Hundreds now understand the authority, their awareness, their alertness. We know your power. We're going to praise God. Send the demonized to us. The psychs can't help them. The drugs can't suppress the demons forever. The jails can only hold the bodies that have the demons in them for so long. The kids in the fantasy books and in the music and all the rest, I'm telling you, church, more is coming. To the point of waves. To the point that instead of us thinking after little girls that get demonized in some level, take another little girl out into the woods to stab because they believe the blood killing of the little girl would, Slender Man would take them to the castle in the woods and take them away. And so the psychs are just saying they're mentally deranged. No, they were spiritually deceived and guided by a spiritually charged fantasy writing. So today, there's a couple of things being outraged. Outrage is not enough. Standing you got to understand how many times in the faces of victims and coming through your state and other places, in Auschwitz, at the Hall of the Dead, in Wadelsburg Castle, places that we've been around the world, where we stand outraged at darkness, outraged at what's to come, outraged concerning the victims that have been just absolutely just ripped and shredded. But even outrage isn't enough. Outrage must be the door that causes us to stand before God and ask for every, listen, in this day, in this hour, do you want half of what God has or everything of what God has? Everybody that says all, please stand. Just please stand. You can look around you, and we understand this, and there's not even, you know, I don't even worry about skeptics and carnal Christians any longer and what they have to say. They can't help themselves, and they can't help anybody else. Heads bowed before the Lord today. Father, I ask in the name of the Lord Jesus, by the Spirit of God, move this place. If there's a gifting, if there's a word, if there's a word of knowledge, if there's an insight, if there's something that needs to be brought forward, let it come forward. We ask right now in the name of Jesus and command that no demon, no demonic assignment, no working of the enemy shall be able to hide. We command that if there's any demon on anyone carried into this place, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, we command you to come forward without any harm to anybody that you'll be dealt with. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, anyone that feels oppressed, anyone that feels there's been something on you, anyone feels in your past, I want you to begin to walk up front here, walk up forward here. If you think there's been something, you know, afflicting you, if you think something has been harming you, just begin to walk up here now. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we acknowledge in the sight, in this spiritual realm right here, every demon should know Jesus Christ is present. The authority of the Lord is present. Right now, we acknowledge this. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, if there is a demon hiding in anyone, on anyone in this place, you are commanded, come forward. You are commanded, you're going to come and be engaged today, now, in the name of the Lord Jesus. Anyone feeling the pressure, anyone feeling something inside, come up forward. Come forward right now. Everybody else can be praying, can be interceding, can be seeking the Lord. In this place today, and I don't know everybody, that's for sure, anybody that's lost, you don't know Jesus Christ yet, you're not saved, Christ is not in you, please understand that God loves you, God summons you, God calls you. Right now, raise your hand, I want to get saved today. Anybody here, I want to get saved today, I want to come to Christ today. Anyone here right now? Pastor Russ, I want you to pray. I want to get saved today. I want to know that I'm born again. I want Christ inside of me. I want to come to Christ right now. Raise your hand. Come on. Anyone here this day? A lot of believers here then, a lot of believers here. Any believers in this place say, you know what, I have knowingly been passive and silent and I can't stand this any longer. I don't want to grieve the Spirit of God. I don't want to quench the Spirit of God. Today, Lord, I want to repent of this, yield my life fully to you. I renounce fear and I want to give you all of my life. I want out of this carnality. I want out of this carnality. I want out of this double life. I want out of living in two, you know, one foot in, one foot out. I want out of this now. You want to make that step today? Raise your hand. Anybody here? All right. A lot of folks, listen, I want you just to pray with me too then. Lord Jesus, I am saved. I know this by a precious blood. You are my Savior. I hate carnality. I hate the flesh. I don't want the world to steal me, to consume me, to imprint on me any of its vileness. I don't want the Spirit of God to be grieved. I don't want the Spirit of God to be quenched. I don't want my life to be half in and half out. I don't want to be an embarrassment, and I don't want to neglect my walk. In the name of the Lord Jesus, I repent. I ask forgiveness. I repent of specific sins, of attitudes. I repent of bitterness, of anger, of revenge, things I've held in my heart. I release the violators. I release them into your hands. You deal with them, Lord. I release them. I forgive them. Spirit of God, search me right now. See if there is any unclean thing in me. See if there's any sin in me that needs to be dealt with. Forgive me, Lord Jesus. I'm stepping out. Here am I. Send me, Lord. I will be a soul winner. I will engage the demonic. I will use that authority. I will have my armor on. I will commit to being aware, to being alert, and I have that authority. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, I rebuke any demon in my family bloodline, any familiar spirit, any generational spirit from grandmothers and grandfathers and moms and dads. I renounce. You will have no place in my life. I am bought by the blood of Jesus. I renounce your activities. You will not engage our family. I draw the line, and in Jesus' name, I renounce your entrance into my family line. I renounce any occult activity, secret society that I've ever given into. With our heads bowed for a moment, eyes closed just for a moment, I'm just asking you, anyone here that is a part of a secret society that says, and you're a believer in Christ, you say, I got to get out of that now. Raise your hand. I got to get out of that right now. Raise your hand. You got to be very clear about it in the society that you live in. Very clear about. What does the temple of God have to do with the temple of Belial? What does light have to do with darkness? In my own life, just pray with me, in my own life, Lord Jesus, I renounce every door I've given to Satan himself and to the demons. I apologize, I repent that I've not used authority, that I've not resisted the devil that he might flee. Today I stand. In the name of Jesus, I renounce all demonic oppression. Every lie that you've sent, I renounce in Jesus' name. And I claim the word of God as truth. I ask today to be refilled, reclothed with God the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, I will not neglect you. I want every gifting, charismatic gifting, that you have given me to manifest in my life, to be used for the common good, to the glory of Christ, in the battle for souls. Lord Jesus, I receive whatever gifting, whatever you want to release in my life, any charismatic gifting that I've neglected, I step forward to use again. Sharpen it to be used well. Anyone lost, you need to come forward, come to Christ. Any other needs, you need to come forward. There's maybe prayer, pastors and others here. If anyone is here that feels they are holding back, you're struggling because something inside is ready to erupt, I want you to just come up here. Get prepared, come up here. Everybody just praying, just be praying. In this place, just say it. We're not letting any demonic presence out of this place without being engaged. Without being engaged by the Lord Jesus. Nothing. Nothing. As the praise team leads and sings, continue to sing. Others who want to come up here and minister, come up here and minister too.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
Master said, go passive and meditate and reach the ascended masters. And if they come near you, let them come into you because they'll bring you great wisdom. In the context of that week, everything was going on in my life as a 19-year-old kid, and I was on the edge of hell itself. I was on the edge. I knew that. I knew that I was lost. I knew that I did not know God. I had great fear in my life, but I was grasping at something until somebody, as I said yesterday, had the guts. Somebody had the spiritual guts. Somebody had such a compelling love for the lost because of their salvation and them being clothed with the Spirit of God. They came into my party on a Friday night. Acid heads, drug heads, pot heads, drinking. The walls were vibrating with metal music. Everything was packed out. People laying on the grass outside, upstairs, every single room of the house. And one man, totally saved, totally transformed, 2 weeks old in the Lord, walked into the apartment and cleared the house. He cleared the house. When he walked into the door, a brightness and a shining, and everybody looked, and he began to witness one by one to everybody in the apartment, everybody in the blazing, you know, pothead and acid head and drug head party was going on. He began to witness to everybody. Nobody stopped him. Nobody looked around. Everybody just set their drugs down. They began to set their beers down. They began to do everything else and run. I ran. I hid from him. I was afraid. You know, when you've got darkness in you and you are lost and you have nothing else to do, but maybe put your life on the edge of hell itself, then when light comes and light strikes that darkness, we all ran. Darkness was running all over the place. One singular, two-week-old, saved, spirit-filled, empowered believer walked into a party like that, and that's where he unleashed the gospel on me. He unleashed the gospel in such a way that I ran from him, went home. That night, the gospel, all of a sudden, I'm sitting there. I didn't know about the Spirit of God convicting of sin, righteousness, and judgment. I didn't know anything about that other than that I was engaged. I was encountered. I was struck. I was struck by the hand of God, and I only knew one thing to do in the middle of the night in my basement of my mom and dad's house, just to get off my bed, get on my knees. Here again, you got a kid that didn't know anything, and this kid didn't understand anything about God. Never prayed, never been in a church service like this. This probably would have scared me. I probably would have loved it, but it would have scared me because I was in the darkness. I was sitting in the darkness. I was doing the stuff. But the Spirit of God convicted and spoke. And that night, you know what I did? I just simply rolled out of my bed and I just said, Jesus, I don't know everything about you, but what these guys have told me, that you would come into my life, that you would save me, that you would give me your power, that you would change my life, that you would deliver me. I just knew all these things that the guy said. And I said, Jesus, come in. And I want you to know that I had a Cornelius experience that night. I mean, God came in, the power of the Spirit came in, God manifested his power, and I tell you what, I was utterly changed, and I closed my eyes talking to Jesus, and all I could do is see myself standing up in front of crowds, preaching Jesus to everybody, pleading for people to come to Christ. I didn't know what a preacher was. I didn't know what a rabbi was. I didn't know what a priest was. You should have seen in the beginning. I didn't know where to buy a Bible. I didn't know there was a Christian bookstore. So I went to Kmart, Blue Light Special, first Bible. I got that Bible. I began to read. I began to do everything with that Bible. Where do you start as a late 60s, early 70s pothead, acid head, crazy man that just got saved, and all that mattered was Jesus was alive and I was delivered and I was ready to go. I ran to my mom. I ran to my dad. I ran to my brothers. They thought I was nuts. There was so much joy and so much peace like a river. It didn't matter. I mean, all I knew was to tell them and tell them and tell them and tell all my friends. Half of all of my friends in 2 weeks got saved. Like dominoes, one by one, they'd either run from us like I ran from the first guy, Steve. They would either run for a while or they would get saved on the spot. It was an astounding time, and I've had over 39 years on the field now, and I've got to see thousands come to Christ all over the place. I've gotten to see some of the neatest things over the years. It has been really quite extraordinary to see the utter, absolute, infallible faithfulness of Jesus Christ in my life and the Spirit of God's work in the context of the battle for the souls of humanity is what it's all about. And so all these years, I've seen the hand of God come. I've seen the salvations come. I have seen in locations the power of God come in such a way to level the crowds and put them on their faces on the ground, where silence in the presence of God went on for 2 hours. A man stood up and finally said, "Be still and know that I'm God." Another wave of God's power just literally leveled everybody in the place, and everybody sat there for another hour weeping in the powerful, powerful presence of God that was absolute. I felt that if I would have opened my eyes, I would have seen God face to face. That powerful presence, that powerful revival was so astounding in that place. Just struck everybody. And that went on for hours that night. And all of a sudden, the next night, people began to show up and everybody showed up in the place. That went on for 6 hours. And the next night, 6 hours. And by the fourth night,
Russ has a very wide experience in the field of law enforcement. He has attended conferences and seminars, including those on satanic ritual abuse, mind control, spiritual warfare, abduction research, evangelism, and more. He's authored and taught over 14 college-level courses over the last 30 years. Russ is the author of The Black Awakening, which you can find back there on the product table. And he has a heart to see people set free from the power of hell. And that's what I like. He's not afraid to call a devil. And he's not afraid of Satan. It seems to me, and I've only sat under Russ now for a day, personally, I've heard him speak on the internet and things of that nature. But it seems to me that one of the things he wants to make the body of Christ extraordinarily aware of is that we are not to be afraid of Satan or his devices. And we are to defy the kingdoms of darkness on every corner and stand up and not be cowards as Satan does his thing out in the earth. We are to take the gospel and combat in spiritual warfare and come against the lying forces of the wicked one. So I'm excited about what God's going to do in this place today. As Brother Russ and I talked about the service this morning months ago, I paraphrase, but I said something like, you know, we can throw the whole conference out the window for Sunday morning. I said, let's just see people get saved. Let's see people get done. I know we're having this conference. I said, but listen, just let God be God. And I remember Brother Russ said, you know, I'm a preacher at heart. Well, that's a good thing. So we don't have to stick to any conference program, any guidelines, anything we've done. We're going to let God have his way in this place. And I pray that someone came in here today that's bound up by demon spirits, and they're going to leave with a new song and a new step and a new spring in their heart today. I'm believing that. So would you welcome Brother Russ Dizdar to the pulpit today at the Tri-State Ministry Center? Thank you, Brother Russ. Thank you so much.
Stand for a moment, please. Thank you very much. You know, in the churches across the nation, we've been telling people for a long time that, you know, we've seen the average prayer time in a church across the nation being about 18 seconds. You know, there's a scripture verse in the book of Revelation talking about being silent in heaven for about a half hour, right? I don't believe that applies to the body of Christ here on the earth right now, okay? What you understand here is, everybody here is a preacher anyway, right? I mean, listen, to come here, we've already heard about three sermons, and that is great, but we're going to hear some more things today that I think that...
Praise the Lord. Go ahead and give him a praise as you're seated this morning. We are in the Days of Noah Prophecy Conference, and we have been in the church since yesterday morning receiving all sorts of teaching and instruction as it pertains to the times that we're living in. How many people know that Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be at the coming of the Son of Man? At another place, we're reminded that it will be like the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. There's a couple things about those days that I don't think we could exhaust in 1 hour, but one thing that really leaps off to me about the days of Noah when I read the pages of my Bible is the fact that Noah was displaying an urgency to people, but people just refused to hear the message that he was trying to convey. The Bible says he preached, and I'm sure he was a preacher. Bible says he was a preacher of righteousness in a world that was full of darkness. He was shining the light, doing what he knew how to do, sounding the alarm, telling people, listen, you better repent, you better turn, you better get your eyes on God, you better come out of this sin. He was shouting the shout. He was blowing the alarm. It was the clarion call that was going forth. But in Noah's day, nobody would listen, as it was in the days of Noah. So shall it be at the coming of the Son of Man. I know there are many other things about the days of Noah that are sobering. But one thing that's shocking is how Noah preached righteousness and declared the truth, but yet only 8 were saved. We have with us today a guest speaker. His name's Brother Russ Dizdar. Yesterday's the first time I ever got to hear Brother Russ speak in person. And I tell you what, I learned a lot of stuff yesterday. How about it, Brother Larry? Russ Dizdar is not afraid to talk about the difficult issues that a lot of people run away from. He's been ordained since 1978, has ministered as a senior pastor for four different churches for more than 30 years. He was also the executive director of Akron Youth for Christ, a police chaplain, founder and director of Shatter the Darkness since 1980, and Preemption Broadcast since 2008. Russ conducts training seminars across the United States as well as crusade evangelism.
In some ways, it's providential, Pastor. It is providential. Let me just begin it this way. You're standing right now, and I feel like I'm going to go for 20 minutes with you standing. So let's do this first. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, God, stretch out your hand in this place. Reach into every single heart in life. God, anyone lost, save. Anyone in any way oppressed, deliver. God, stretch out your hands to heal. And God, in this place, perform miraculous signs and wonders. In the name of your holy servant, Jesus, in this state, in this city, we ask you to bring a radical, a ripping and tearing to the underground, to the darkness, to what's going on all around us. And God, show your hand in this city, in this state, in the areas around, and by the providence of God, those who have come from long distances, God, meet them, speak to them, God, loudly or in that small, still voice that is so clear that it answers everything and liberates. We ask God, stretch out your hands to the right of us, to the left of us, behind us, before us. Stretch out your hands to bring your great salvation, your great power, your great might to everyone around. Stretch out your hands to destroy the work of the enemy. As Michael the Archangel said it, we say today, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord rebuke you, Satan. Father, we love you today, and we ask you right now, acknowledging, Lord Jesus, you are here, you are present, your presence is unbroken, unceasing, we surrender, we yield. Holy Spirit, we love you, we yield. And God, grant your gifts, grant your revival, come and just clothe this place in great power. In Jesus' name, everybody says, amen. You can be seated, amen. Now listen, I come to you from a strange background that you have in the past with me, and I shared this last night. I'll do it quickly here. You know, in 1975, there was a 19-year-old kid that was dabbling in the occult, dabbling in the dark side, you know, fighting in bars and drinking and being an acid head and doing everything else into the 60s and the beginning of the 70s. All this stuff was going on in this kid's life. He didn't know where else to go. Wasn't raised in church. Didn't know this. No one touched him with the power of God. No one brought Jesus to him. Wasn't raised at all in any kind of church whatsoever. Didn't know, but maybe a verse of scripture somehow, some way, he heard somewhere, but didn't know a thing. Understood that God was there, but God was not here. And he was in a great search in his life. In the end of those teenage years, that young kid got into Buddhism and went to a temple, and the temple